It's in the air. And he's put it down. Mike Smith down on the boundary. Elliott has hooked, miscued again.
Well, that's not really a day Mike Smith will want to remember. He made a duck and then had a chance dropped by Thorpe. He could have had Elliott at 29, and now he's dropped a chance himself. And there was one more run added to take the Australian score along to 258 for four at the close of play. A fine performance there from Elliott. That's a great partnership. Wonderful counter-attack by those two young players, gifted stroke players, and they did wonderfully well for the Australians. 134 and 86 respectively for Elliott and Ponting. Now the four wickets taken by Goff and Headley. Everyone bowled quite well there, but once the Australians got cracking, they really didn't have an answer. It was just a super partnership, and hard though England tried, they weren't able to break through again to pick up that crucial fifth wicket. So the state of play at the end of 2 days, and bear in mind there are only 36 overs bowled on the first day. The Australians are 86 runs ahead at 258 for four against 172 all out.
First on BBC Two, despite the rain, they did manage to squeeze in a couple of hours' play at Headingley today in the fourth test. Richie Benno introduces the highlights.
Another tough day at the office for Australians Matthew Elliott and Ricky Ponting. They should have an easier start this morning than was the case yesterday. After Jason Gillespie's seven wickets had bundled England out for 172 just before lunch, the Australians had slumped to 50 for four when Ponting joined Elliott. The first innings lead, I can assure you, looked to be a long, long way off. But with some brilliant and very confident stroke play, they put on over 200 to blunt the England attack and lift their side clear of trouble. Dropped by England on three separate occasions yesterday, Elliott went on to make his second century of the series. Well, welcome to the highlights of the third day of this Cornhill Test match at Headingley, the fourth in the series, and it was a day of wonderful counter-attack. Brilliant stuff, some of the best I've seen in years, and this is the way it all began this morning. Four for 258. The Australians. Taylor out for naught, Blewett for one, Mark Waugh for eight, and Steve Waugh for four. That was potential disaster. Elliott, 134, and Ponting, 86, saw them out of it. And the bowling figures for England, 2 for 65 for Goff, Headley, 2 for 66, and the other four used Mike Smith, Mark Elam, then Croft, and Butcher. Now, the state of the game on the third morning, the Australians, 86 runs ahead, and just a terrific effort from Matthew Elliott and Ricky Ponting there on the bottom left. Well, batting certainly was a little easier yesterday afternoon than was the case earlier in the day. Let's have a word now with Geoffrey Boycott and see what he thinks will happen out there on this third morning.
Yesterday, Mike Smith bowled a ball to Matthew Elliott that bounced a little bit and Graham Thorpe dropped a sitter at slip. It was the key moment of the day. And it just shows that early on when the ball is hard and shiny, that was the 17th over, there's still a little bit of movement and bounce in this pitch. We look at it Saturday morning, third day, hasn't changed a lot. There's still a little bit of grassy areas. Here you are, they're still there, quite fresh. We've still got the crazy paving look. And I think the key moment today, with this pitch not changing a lot, is when England take the new ball, something fairly newish like that in about 13 overs time. Race seam, quite hard, there'll still be a little bit of movement, an extra bounce occasionally, and England have to make it count this morning because there still will be something in this pitch. And if they don't make it count and get wickets, then Australia are going to bat them quickly out of the game.
Well, still a bit there for the bowlers, but the main point, as Geoffrey makes, is that they will have to bowl well. We join it now with Darren Goff bowling the second over of the day. Ricky Ponting is taking strike and four runs have been added to the overnight total.
Now that's exactly what Darren Goff wants to see. It was a no ball. That would have been very disappointing if that actually had gone up off the glove. But that really spat at Ricky Ponting. Very nasty delivery. Now that's a very nasty delivery. It was a no ball. Matthew Elliott got himself in a real tangle. Well, somehow escaped. Well, it's that helmet again that's done the trick.
He's got a nice easy boundary there. Perhaps a little fortunate. Quite a thick edge, but away to the boundary.
Well, full credit to him as Australia's lead passes the 100 mark. He's batted beautifully here. That's a fine shot. He beats the dive too. Michael Atherton might just have covered that. It was beautifully struck. Just for a moment there, Ricky Ponting was stuck on 87, the number that all Australians dread. The edge through the slips took him off that, and this was a far better shot. That's a lovely shot too. Third boundary of the over. That one just a little bit shorter, and the adjustment was perfect by Ricky Ponting.
Now, I think that's an area where he's better than Elliott. He's only a small man, but he plays the back foot cover drive magnificently. That's the second one of those we've seen in this match. The timing is exquisite.
Yeah, you see. He's far more comfortable, as I was, when the ball goes offside and he can just swing back and sway out of the way. If you get stuck side on like that, and for a moment here he's thinking, whoops, and then it's the fact that the ball has drifted down leg side that's taking the problem away. A little bit late on that. No, I didn't really seem to pick that up properly.
Well, he's still thinking about the short pitch one, I'm sure. That's perhaps why he's a little late. That one, fortunately for Matthew Elliott, a touch high.
Get it! He's called for it and got it. Very well played indeed, Ricky Ponting. Isn't he delighted? Ricky Ponting's maiden Test 100, and he really has played beautifully. Applauded by all his colleagues in the Australian management. That's been a brilliant innings. That's high and square, couple of bounces, and over the ropes at square leg. No confusion in his mind what happens when Darren Goff drops short, as the Yorkshireman's just discovered. Big shout now. Where's that pitched? Not out, says Cyril Mitchley. Looked as though Matthew Elliott had moved across right in front of the stumps. It's a question whether or not that ball pitched on the line of the stumps. Might just have been outside leg stump. Good decision from Cyril Mitchley. Right arm over the wicket to the left-hander. Has to try and get that ball to come back in if he's going to get LBWs.
Well fielded. Good anticipation there. That was struck just about off the meat of the bat, and the fielder out at cover was very quick to go across. Nasser Hussain, he was going to his right as the ball was hit.
That turned.
That won't have gone unnoticed by the Australians. Well, the signal leg byes. Well, did he actually play a shot at that?
That's nicely played. Not deterred at all by the fact that the previous ball spun sharply. He was down the track and hitting it beautifully away over mid-wicket. A lovely controlled stroke.
Yes, the footwork was good. He'd obviously made up his mind that if it's tossed up, he's going to get down the pitch to it. Didn't try to hit it too hard, just lofted it in the air and cleared the infield quite easily. What they need is a little bit of luck. Obviously, they've got to try and make something happen themselves, but sometimes a little bit of good fortune. A wicket that comes from nowhere, a run out, anything, just to get a new batsman in and then take the new ball at Healy and the tail. Just opens up one end if you can sneak a wicket before you take the new ball. And there it was. There was the opportunity. It was lovely bowling. That's how he tossed it up. You see the replay. He just teased Ricky Ponting. Beautifully executed was the bowling. Look at that, just tossed it up, missed it, and Stewart's made a mess of it.
Good shot for four. That brings up the 300. .250 stand between Elliott and Ponting. Lovely stroke from Ponting. And 302 for four, the Australians at four and over. Second new ball is on with Dean Headley, and Elliott has picked up three from that straight drive. Slightly lofted. Ricky Ponting. Oh, good shot. Just a gentle little defensive push. It'll get onto those pitches and race away from the fieldsman. Headley can hardly believe it. He stood there looking at Ponting for a long time. Nothing more than a defensive push. He's creamed back. Goff's given him quite a bit of width there. Trying to get the away swinger going. And Ponting has belted it. Going to be out. Yes, Elam has got it. Ponting has gone. Goff has the wicket. Ponting out for 127. Goff just got a little bit of extra pace there. Put a bit more into it after that slashing square drive. A flash to the boundary. And Ponting will receive a standing ovation here from this capacity crowd.
Well, it was a real classy innings, was that? Splendid knock. Just came on a little bit quicker. And that's the breakthrough England needed.
Ian Healy. Come out now to replace Ponting. Ponting caught Elam Bowl Goff 127. Splendid partnership between Ponting and Elliott. He's still there on 141.
And there's the rate per 100 balls. Australia up to 63. In comes Headley. Another cracking start, and that's a beautiful stroke. I even say the ball asked for it, but it was a marvellous start by Ian Healy, and smiling alongside me is Ian Chappell.
It's not a bad way to get off the mark, is it? I guess the bowler can reasonably expect that the batsman might have a look at the first one, but that's not the way Ian Healy plays.
Slower ball, and it's
carved away over gully, and that's four runs. Well, Ian Healy's come in as if he's got 40 to get off the last eight balls of a one-day international match.
Yep.
Well placed. Three runs.
That's a very good chase. I think Goff just holding his head with his hands there. That's a sign making the chase. I think Goff felt that he'd almost got that one in the right position.
Oh, no ball called, but that's a bit more like it. Ian Healy's come in and he's been wafting the bat like a magic wand out there. Crashed a couple of fours. When with this new ball, England really want to see more playing and nicking. Thorpe at first slip, then Butcher and Hussain.
White.
And that's through again. Well, Ian Healy's in terrific form there. That was a long half volley. Darren Goff, I expect, looking to get some swing from this new ball. But there's not much out there for him. I've no doubt at all that the England bowlers are looking to keep it up there just to get some movement in the air, but really there is none to report. No hesitation at all, ladling that away through the covers.
Yep.
Oh, that was a cracking shot. Beautifully played. You'd say that it was very unorthodox. It's outside off stump. And that's 150 to Matthew Elliott. And really, right from the start, an innings packed with style. Wonderful correct technique in defence, but some crashing attacking strokes.
No.
Good effort in the field. Mark Elam's a useful cricketer. Interesting. Oh, gosh, missed an open goal.
Quick call from Ian Healy. Now he's just got to race Mark Elam, and even if Elam had knocked all three to the ground with his little soccer kick, wouldn't have done him any good.
Oh, well, the short square leg was there an over ago, has been moved back to square leg, and that would have been a sitter. Unless it had gone over his head, I suppose. Well, a little bit short, and Ian Healy's in terrific form, picked it out straight away. And Mark Elam has looked effective. He's pitched the ball up a little further than that, but that had width, it was short, it stood up. And Ian Healy's thoroughly enjoying himself out there. Now moved on to 20.
He can add some more runs now too. On the up, hammered away through the offside. And on a pitch like this, against a batsman like this, anything like that is rather inviting. Nicely taken. It's never much fun, these, for the keepers. Down the leg side, flicking the pad. And then it's always a bit of a guessing game as to how that ball's going to bounce. at first. Long, hard look at it from Mervyn Kitchen. But I'm convinced this was pad first, then the bat suddenly jabbed down and made contact afterwards. That's as good a shout as you'll get.
Oh, again.
Well, I think Ian Healy at this stage would rather he had been given out. Having all sorts of trouble. Well, that's swatted away. That's the relief that Ian Healy wanted. After a dodgy over or so. Just getting something there from Mike Smith which he could help round to square leg. And up comes the 50 partnership.
Two more runs were added to take it along to 373 for five when the rain came along. A very good performance there from Matthew Elliott, pushing up towards the 200 mark. Lovely innings from Ricky Ponting. He's a very, very good player, 127 for him. And Ian Healy, in typical style, came out and hit a quick fire 27 and was also unbeaten. Bowling figures for England, Darren Goff 3 for 104 and Dean Headley 2 for 105, have all 5 wickets between them. I thought Elam bowled quite well again this morning. He's only into his 11th over and the Australians have made plenty of runs. No wicket for 24 for him, and Croft got a bit of spin, which Warne will like to see. None for 45 in 16. So the situation at the end of the third day, another rain-marred day. The Australians just over 200 runs ahead, 373 for 5. Elliott and Ponting the stars there, and Ricky Ponting talked after the washout with Simon Hughes.
Ricky, it was your maiden century in your first Ashes test. What an amazing achievement.
Yeah, I feel pretty good actually. I mean, I've been out of the side for a little while. I think I missed 8 test matches after being dropped halfway through last summer. So yeah, it was a thrill for me to get picked, you know, again to play in an Ashes test, and you know, I think I've made the most of the chance.
How did you deal with that time out of the side?
It was pretty tough. It was, you know, fairly tough on me early. I went back to Sheffield Shield cricket and tried to make things happen really quickly. And as it turned out, they didn't. But towards the end of the season, you know, I started batting well again and the runs started coming. So, you know, I was happy to be back on the trip and I'm happy to play my first Ashes test again, yeah.
You came in a tricky situation at 50 for 4.
Yeah, a little bit of a tricky situation, but I think by then the wicket had, you know, flattened out quite a bit, I think. You know, most of our batters got out in unusual ways and you know, the first 3 or 4 got out, you know, funnily. So the wicket had flattened out and it was up to me and Matty to hang around for a while and, you know, take the shine off the ball and get a few into the gaps and see how we go.
How did you approach those first few overs? You said the wicket was flatter. You looked quite positive.
Yeah, I tried to be as positive as I could. I think Matty said that last night as well, that he went out, you know, on that wicket to be as positive as he could and play his strokes. So I had the same sort of philosophy and it had come off, yeah.
And you didn't spend long in the 90s this time.
Yeah, been there before and got out of my first test on 96, so I was pretty keen to get through the 90s as quick as I could today, yeah.
And then reaching the 100, how did that feel?
Yeah, it was a great feeling. You know, me and Matty had planned to be as, you know, together for as long as we could, and I think we put on 260-odd or something. It would have nice to have been about 40 more, because I think Steve Waugh and Alan Border put on 316 and we were trying to beat that, but I let Matty down and it wasn't to be, so.
Yeah, you batsmen, you never like getting out, do you, even if you've got a big score?
For sure. As I said, the wicket had flattened out and the ball was coming onto the bat nicely. So, you know, it would have been nice to hang around for a bit longer and, you know, maybe get over 150 would have been great.
Your nickname in the team is Punter. Tell us why.
I like to have a bit of a gamble. I own some horses and some greyhounds at home and race those. So, you know, 3 or 4 nights a week, I'm usually down at the local pub having a bet on Sky Channel. So I think that's where the nickname come from, yeah.
And as far as other sports go, you're a bit handy with the clubs, aren't you?
Yeah, well, most of the guys play a fair bit of golf, and I certainly play a fair bit when I'm at home. Haven't got a lot else to do other than go down to the golf course during the day. So, yeah, I play a bit of golf, and, you know, it's gone pretty well while I've been here as well.
What happened at St Andrews?
Well, I finished double bogey for 75, so I let myself down a little bit there, but that's the way it goes. I hit it into the rough on the last 2 holes and couldn't get it out, basically, so I had to be happy with 75, yeah.
Back on the field, you're now in a strong position. How do you see the game going?
Yeah, well, it's important now that Matty and Heels go on and you know, get as many out of, you know, the last few batters as we can and get a, you know, a 300-plus lead would be great. we think the wicket might start to be a bit variable in the bounce of, over the next couple of days. So, you know, if we get that 300 lead, no doubt the wicket will start playing a few tricks, yeah.
Well, as a pom, it pains me to say it, but well played.
Yeah, thanks very much.
Well, that 300 lead will be OK so long as the Australian captain doesn't delay the declaration too long. And nice to hear the congratulations there for Ricky Ponting. He is a very talented player, and he was just as talented when he was dropped from the Australian side just a little time after making 88 against the West Indies, as he is in this innings here at Headingley. Now, with their ideas on what happened today and what might be coming up in the remaining 2 days of play, here's Geoffrey Boycott and with him Ian Chappell.
Besides the fact that England couldn't get any wickets this morning, I think one of the other problems was that they couldn't stop the scoring rate, which was, what, 4 and over, was lightning quick compared with a lot of test matches.
Yeah, I think England maintained discipline fairly well in the early parts of that partnership between Elliott and Ponting, but in the end I think they were just beaten into submission by some very, very good batting. And there were some bad signs for England when Ian Healy came in. Then there was a lot of loose balls, discipline had disappeared, the old shoulders were slumping, and I thought they were just about ready to put their hands up and say, we're surrendering.
Yeah. Well, that's what I was worried about from England's point of view, is that the game was getting away from them quickly, just racing away. And if you can't get wickets, you do have to exercise some control over the game. And by creating some kind of pressure through good bowling and better catching, then you might get a wicket or two and get back into the game.
Well, I think there'll be some wickets on hand when Australia bowl. I think the Australian quickies will... they won't bowl any more better balls than what England bowled, but they won't bowl as many bad ones, and there'll be some more in the danger area, and I think that it'll be enough. They'll get enough in the danger area to get the 10 wickets.
Well, it's been rain today, but there's 2 fair days apparently on the horizon, and I don't see England surviving. They may play a bit better, but I don't hold out much hope for England here.
No, when they haven't, what, they haven't made 250 for, you know, I think we've virtually got to go back to the first test since they've done that. So there's no track record there to suggest that they're suddenly going to come out of this batting slump that they're in. They've got some problems, I think.
They're in serious trouble.
Yeah, there's plenty of work to be done by England there, not only with the ball for the remainder of this Australian innings, but also with the bat when they have to go out at their second attempt. We'll be back on BBC tomorrow. It'll be the fourth day of this fourth Cornhill Test at Headingley. BBC One at 10:45 a.m. And we leave you in this rain-marred third day with Ricky Ponting, a tremendous young player, and a fine performance from him in this Test match where he made his first Test match 100.